yourself?
I was a very nice guy. Actually, I was one of the quieter guys in school because I was kind of young for my year. My birthday's in September, so I was like of that younger age. So I was kind of hung out in the back and just tried to sort of be quiet and not get in too much trouble. Well, I guess going to Catholic school teaches you that too. If you stand out too much, you get whacked. So I made sure to tell my jokes kind of secretly. But I had a lot of practice at home because our dinner tables were just like raucous events where all the brothers would be around, you know, spilling milk, ripping chicken legs off the chicken. And you'd have to find a way to survive at the dinner table. So my older brother, Jim, who became a lawyer, actually learned how to talk very fast. Yeah, so my technique was to crack up the family, make everybody laugh. And while they were laughing, I could make a grab for some more chicken, which has served me well even today. And then actually to learn how to survive in that just kind of crazy mix of like six guys really comes in handy. But you know what, that's the thing too, that's interesting, that having grown up with all boys in our family, and then I actually went to high school at Culver Military Academy, which was all guys up until my senior year. And then from there, when I went into elementary school teaching, it was like whiplash, because I was in these all-guy worlds, and then suddenly I was in this all-female world, and I had no idea where I was. It was like people talking about feelings. They wanted to hear what other people had to say. You actually had to listen to other people. You couldn't just wrestle them. I think maybe that was probably the low point of my early career, is trying to wrestle people in the faculty lounge. Geez, I'd be scared to think what kind of teacher kids thought I was. I think I was kind of like not a particularly in-control teacher. But maybe that's a good thing, I think, that I brought to the classroom as a guy, having lived with five brothers. A lot of stuff just didn't faze me, like an unbelievable noise level in my classroom, which I noticed was a little different from some of the ladies' classes down the hall, or Miss Alberti, who was in first grade, and everyone listened quietly. I never could get them to do that thing where everyone sits in the circle and listens to each other. After, you know, and mostly I think because they saw through it and they thought, he doesn't do that. We don't have to do that. But luckily I worked in a school where the headmaster was a great supporter of me too. And one time he said, like, Scieszka, we have a hard time like taking pictures of your class. Like, we go in there and everyone's out of their seats and you just see their butts up in the air. And I thought I was in trouble. And the next thing he said was, though, you know, I like that though. It means they're interested. And they were. There's pictures of kids like hunched over the table and they're like looking at the science stuff we're doing, or they're checking out the mealworms, or they're playing with the math materials. And so I always tried to really motivate kids by getting them excited about stuff. And even being a little mysterious about it, just saying like, I don't know, we got this stuff, we have to figure it out, it's up to you guys. And then just lay something on them. And I always found that really piqued their interest better than lecturing them. I think I learned from teaching it was a more effective way to motivate kids by getting them interested rather than lecturing them. So my approach was with books was not to say, you know, reading is wonderful or reading is magic, or even kind of lecture them where we say, like, you know, you have to read if you want to be a real citizen. Because that, I don't know, that just doesn't make sense to kids at that young age. It makes so much more sense if you read the first chapter of a cliffhanger and just leave it hanging there and they say, what happens next? You go, I don't know, you have to read it. And then just leave the book there. That was a really funny, weird, quirky thing that I actually met up with Lane, because most authors never even work with their illustrator. But I happened to meet him through my wife and his wife worked together on magazines. I was trying to publish stories and nobody was liking them. I met Lane, he was trying to get some books going. Everyone thought his artwork was too weird. But then we met up with each other and I showed Lane the story of the three little pigs and he read it and he thought, wow, this is great. He did the first painting of the wolf and I just thought, oh, that's what he would look like. This would be perfect. So we took that out and tried to sell it to people and got rejected all over the place again. Because some people would say, like, I like the paintings, but I don't like the story so much. Other people look at the story and go, I kind of like the story. The paintings are too dark. And sophisticated was a word they used a lot in a bad way to say, like, you know, this is too sophisticated for kids. They won't understand. I actually started writing thinking more I would be writing for adults. I actually got a master's in fiction writing from Columbia, which then led me to paint apartments in New York, because that's about all you can do with an MFA in fiction writing. But I was thinking like adults would be a great audience until I started teaching second grade and just saw how smart these little guys were. But in different ways. I mean, it's not like they're going to explain something to you or write a position paper, but they just understand what's going on. So I knew they would understand Three Little Pigs Told by the Wolf, or they would understand like goofing around with fairy tales. So I think that's kind of what informs all my writing. I always sort of go back to just how smart those little kids are. And I just sort of know that at some deep level. I think I was lucky to have been a teacher for so long, for 10 years, that it just kind of seeped into me. So I don't consciously think about teaching a lesson, because that really seems to kill a book. Like if you've got too much of a moral or a message that you're trying to get across. But I just kind of try to let it come out of the story. And then I hear after the fact, like from a million teachers who have told me that they use Three Little Pigs to teach different points of view, which I think is spectacular. But I didn't sit down thinking like, now how would I teach different points of view? Let's have the wolf tell the story. Or with Stinky, I realized like how much fun that would be to mess up storytelling in as many ways as I possibly could. And I think that's where I really get along with Lane. Like that's his take on the world too, is like, how can I make this funnier? How can I do this so like the Stinky Cheese Man looks like the funniest thing you've ever seen? And so now that we've been working together for so long, I like to kind of set challenges for him too. Like, how would you illustrate a character that's a beef snack stick? Which he did in Squids Will Be Squids. Or in the science stuff, the science verse, I've got one verse that's Mary had a little worm. She thought it was a chigger. But everything that Mary ate only made it bigger. It came with her to school one day and gave the kids a fright, especially when the teacher said, now that's a parasite. And I just wondered, like, all right, so how's Lane going to illustrate a little kid with a parasite? Little, and he's got Mary with little curls, and he just kind of did this nice cutaway of her stomach with a kind of a cute little worm. But I had no idea what he was going to do. I was kind of amazed that he got out of that, though. So Guys Read is a literacy program for boys that I started about 3 years ago. I think it was 2002, 2003. Just to specifically address the problem of how boys are having trouble reading. And a big piece of the effort, the literacy effort, was just to say, let's check this out. We know boys are having trouble reading. Parents know it. Teachers know it. We've been testing kids for 25 years and finding that boys are doing worse than girls as a group. But nobody's done anything about it. And it's so frustrating, like people haven't even studied it as it might be a gender-related problem. It's so concrete that we can just give boys books that they enjoy and not try to force them to read other books that we enjoy, but to say, hey, what books do boys like to read? To collect that information from people and then spread that around to other boys. So there's a couple things that boys like to read that aren't really seen as legitimate reading in school. Nonfiction is a big one. Boys want to read information and find out about something that's happening. They really are not that crazy about, you know, like what happened to little Laura on the prairie. I mean, that was my experience with my son. He struggled through those required reading books of Little House on the Prairie. And in some ways, they're good books. But for him as a third grader, that was not a good book. It just turned him off. Humor is another big one. For some reason, I mean, it hardly ever gets assigned in schools. It's just not seen as legitimate reading. And boys, that's just like the thing they live and breathe. Captain Underpants is just such a great series of books. It just just the word Captain Underpants gets boys excited about, like, oh, I'd like to read that. But the boys get the message from the teachers who are kind of going like, that's not really reading. Visual storytelling is another one. Like the graphic novels that are available now are a great way to get boys excited who aren't too crazy about text. And they really have advanced from what they were as, say, comic books before. So now the biggest part of the program is just to get people to sort of carry that message on of how we can help boys read. And across the country, there's been some nice things libraries are doing where they set up their own guys read divisions within the public libraries in a classroom. And just some of it's as easy as, say, like, let's just make a shelf that has all these suggested titles that boys like. So let's have Seymour Simon's nonfiction. Let's have Dave Pilkey's humor stuff, Jack Gantos. Let's have graphic novels. Let's have magazines, information kind of text. And then boys feel a little better, like they don't have to go shop around this whole reading world. They can go to the shelf and like find a good book or find one that they might like. A lot of the stuff that guys like Michael Gurian do really get into the way male and female brains are different, how males see motion more than color and texture, which explains all kinds of really interesting things. Like you see a kindergarten boy drawing a picture of like a rocket ship and it's one black crayon and he's going, it's blasting off, it's going to the moon, and he just keeps scribbling over it as he's describing the picture. And then you see like little Jennifer's picture next to him, and it's a family that's in a little house and they're all inside the rocket ship and they're in full color and she can describe the relationship of everybody. And so when the kindergarten teacher comes up and she looks at Jennifer's picture and goes, that's beautiful. Then she goes over and see our little guy's picture and goes, what the hell's going on here? Like, what happened? And he's going, what? But boys are just different from girls that way. And we don't accommodate kids when they're that young, which is scary that we're not seeing, like, they're different that way. So all that stuff blends over into reading, what we're having them read, the ways we're having them learn how to read. Like my boys in second grade just needed to get up and move around a lot. I think I understood that from having brothers and why it didn't bug me that kids were wandering around in my classroom. I know they don't sit still, and that's all right. They can still listen, like their ears still work while they're moving around. Just had to keep them within limits.
The Reading Rockets Meet the Author series is a production of WETA. Major funding for Reading Rockets comes from the United States Department of Education, Office of Special Education Programs. For more author interviews, recommended reading lists, and information about teaching kids to read, please visit us online at www.readingrockets.org.